come to your next theorem. This is theorem 13. You are all welcome in this class. The theorem says that if a function f is monotonic on closed interval AB, then it is integrable on closed interval AB. Monotonic means a function may be increasing or may be decreasing. We shall prove the theorem when f is monotonic increasing. In this theorem, we have taken f to be monotonic increasing, and the result can be proved if f is your monotonic decreasing. See, since f is your bounded, therefore epsilon greater than 0 be given. Since we have taken f to be monotonic increasing, therefore in the closed interval f will be bounded. Let epsilon greater than 0 be given. Let us choose a number eta less than epsilon by fb minus fa plus 1. We have taken this because we need this latter term. That is why we have taken eta to be less than epsilon by fb minus fa plus 1. We now choose a partition p given as x0, x1, x2, so on, xn of closed interval ab, where x0 is small a and xn is small b, with norm mu p less than eta. See, norm mu p is your less than eta. Since f is monotonic increasing, therefore capital MI will be fxi and small MI will be fxi minus 1. I is varying from 1 to n in the interval in delta xi, which is subinterval of this partition. Next, you need to evaluate UPF minus LPF. So as per the definition, UPF will be summation capital MI delta XI, and minus LPF is your summation small MI delta XI. So we'll take delta XI common. So it will be summation I is equal to 1 to n capital MI minus small MI delta XI. Now this is equal to summation I is equal to 1 to n fxi minus 1 delta XI. Substitute the values of capital MI and small MI. And it will be less than eta times summation I is equal to 1 to n fxi minus 1. Why? Because this delta xi mu p here on delta xi, this is less than eta. So this is less than this one. Next, this eta is less than this one. So we will substitute here. So it is less than epsilon by fb minus fa plus 1 into fab minus fa. The result of this summation is your fb minus fa. And since fb minus fa by fb minus fa plus 1, it should be less than 1. So the whole result is less than epsilon. Therefore, f is integrable because UPF minus LPF is less than epsilon, hence f is integrable. So we have proved that a monotonic increasing function is integrable. Similarly, we can show that a monotonic decreasing function is also integrable. See here, it is a note, fb minus fa plus 1 have been taken to cover the case when fa is equal to fb. Suppose you have a chance when fa is equal to fb, then if this plus 1 is not here, the denominator will be 0, so meaningless. That is why this plus 1 is given here. Next, there is an example. See this example. Show that the function f defined as follows. Fx is equal to 1 upon 2 to the power n. When 1 upon 2 to the power n is less than x, which is less than or equal to 1 upon 2 to the power n, n is equal to 0, 1, 2, and so on. And f0 is equal to 0. See here, you can see that in the interval 0 to 1, in the closed interval 0 to 1, this function is increasing. You need to show that this is integrable on closed interval 0, 1. See here, now we have fx is equal to 1. Substitute here, n is equal to 0. So for n is equal to 0, this will be 1 upon 2 to power 0 means 1. And here n is equal to 0 means 1 upon 2 less than x less than equal to 1 upon 2 to the power 0 means 1. So fx is equal to 1, where 1 upon 2 less than x less than or equal to 1 by 1 means 1. And this is 1 by 2, when 1 upon 2 square less than x less than or equal to 1 by 2. When we substitute n is equal to 1 here, and so on, 1 upon 2 to the power n minus 1, when 1 upon 2 to the power n is less than x, less than or equal to 1 upon 2 to the power n minus 1, for n minus 1 here, and it is trending, so on it is zero when x is equal to zero. This is, see here, f zero is your zero. See that this f is monotonic, bounded, and monotonic increasing. See the function f is bounded and monotonic increasing on this closed interval AB. Hence, from the earlier theorem, this function f will be integrable. So this is a good example for you. There are several examples. You just need to practice them. See here, f is continuous on closed interval 0, 1, except at the points 0, 1 by 2, 1 by 2 squares, 1 by 2 cube, and so on, which have only one limit point 0, hence f is integrable. You not need to go this one. Next, we have two very important theorems. Fundamental theorem of integral calculus. There are two theorems, first theorem and second theorem. First, we will study first fundamental theorem of integral calculus, and after that we will study second fundamental theorem of integral calculus. See what is there for your, see theorem 16. If a function f is bounded and integrable on this closed interval AB, then the function capital F, defined as capital Fx is equal to integration from a to x small ft dt, a is less than or equal to x, less than or equal to b, is continuous on closed interval AB. So we need to prove that for a bounded function f, bounded integrable function on this closed interval AB, this function is continuous. And furthermore, if a small f is continuous at a point c of closed interval AB, then capital F is derivable at c, and f dash c is equal to small f c. See its proof. Since small f is bounded, therefore there exists a number k greater than 0 such that modulus of fx is less than or equal to k for all x in this closed interval AB. Because this f is bounded, so we will have this number capital K for which mod fx will be less than or equal to this k. If we have two points x1, x2 of this closed interval AB such that a is less than or equal to x1, less than x2, less than or equal to b, then modulus of fx2 minus fx1 will be equal to modulus of integration from x1 to x2 ft dt. From this definition of fx, it should be less than or equal to k times x2 minus x1. See here, earlier we have studied result that this modulus of this one is less than k times x2 minus x1, where this f is less than or equal to k, modulus of f is less than or equal to k. So from that theorem we get this one. Thus, for a given epsilon greater than 0, we see that modulus of fx2 minus fx1 will be less than epsilon if mod x2 minus x1 is less than epsilon by k. See here, this way mod x2 minus x1 is less than epsilon by k. Substitute here, then you will get here epsilon. So the result, fx mod fx2 minus fx1 is less than epsilon. Hence, the function f is continuous as per the definition of continuity of functions. Therefore, the function f is continuous. In fact, this is continuous on this closed interval, so it is uniformly continuous. So our first part is proved that this function is continuous on this closed interval AB. Now we need to show that f dash c is equal to small fc when f is continuous at a point c. See, let small f be continuous at a point c of closed interval AB, so that for any epsilon greater than 0, there exists delta greater than 0, such that mod fx minus fc is less than epsilon for mod x minus c less than delta. This is for continuity of f. We have this result, this definition. According to definition, if f is continuous, this then this result, this is, this will hold. Let c minus delta less than s, less than or equal to c, less than or equal to t, less than c plus delta. We have taken. So modulus of ft minus fs by t minus s minus fc. This is taken as because we need to get the differentiation f dash x, means f dash c. For f dash c, we need to just take limit of this one. So modulus of ft minus fs over t minus s minus fc is equal to 1 upon t minus s integration from s to t fx minus fc dx. See here, substitute the value of this ft minus fs from the definition of fx here. If you substitute the values of ft minus fs, then you will get this integration sign 1 upon t minus s integration from S to T fx. But here we have, you have also minus fc, so it is minus fc dx. So it is less than or equal to 1 upon t minus s integration from s to t modulus fx minus fc dx, and it will be less than epsilon. Therefore, capital F dash c is equal to small fc. So this result is, this result is also proved. So you have proved the first fundamental theorem of integral calculus. That is, here continuity of f at any point of closed interval AB implies derivability of f at that point. See here. See, this theorem is sometimes referred to as the first fundamental theorem of integral calculus. You just need to practice this theorem in your note copy, write in your note copy. Only then you can get over this theorem. Otherwise, it will be very tough for you to get this one. So, see here, there is a remark. We shall now show with the help of an example this continuity of a function is not a necessary condition for the existence of a primitive. Means functions possessing primitives are not necessarily continuous. See here a very good example. Consider the function f on closed interval AB, where this fx is given as 2x sin 1 by x minus cos 1 by x if x is non-zero and 0 when x is 0. This function fx is not continuous at x is equal to 0. It has a primitive f where capital Fx is equal to x square sin 1 by x if x is non-zero and 0 if x is 0. So here, if you differentiate this function fx, capital Fx, you will get this small fx. Clearly, f dash x, capital F dash x is equal to small fx, but this fx is not continuous at x is equal to 0. Earlier, we have, in your earlier classes, you have shown that this type of function is not continuous at x is equal to 0. That is, fx is not continuous on closed interval AB. So you have f dash x is equal to small fx. It means derivative of a function is not necessarily continuous. So after this, it is over from my side. In my next class, you will have this fundamental theorem of calculus, means you have the second form of fundamental theorem of integral calculus. Till now, if you have any query, you just give me a message on WhatsApp, or the whole lecture will be available on YouTube. There is a comment section. You can give your comments there also.